I got several things I want to talk to you about. I got three main things. You're going to be talking about effective listening, communication, and leadership. I want to mix in some kind of technical stuff with that on how-tos, examples, some personal experiences that I've had in various situations, and I want to bring in some really, really good speakers and very knowledgeable people that are much, much more knowledgeable than me and much better speakers than I am. So you'll have several videos involved in my presentation. I hope you enjoy it. I thank you so much for coming out, especially on an inclement weather night like this. I want to ask you, did you like the Chinese food tonight? Yeah, okay. How would you like Mexican next month? All right, okay. You heard him, Gail. Craig, if you'll run the first video, please.
Inspiring true performance.
A number of years ago, Larry Majors, my executive assistant, got a phone call from a lady in Birmingham, Alabama. At the end of the conversation, she said, "Zig," she said, "I believe this woman thinks she's got an impossible problem, but I believe you can solve that problem with her in just a few minutes if you will spend that time with her." I said, "Well, Larry, tell her to meet me backstage. I'll get there about 10 minutes early." My schedule was such that was about all I had. Well, I got there, and I was on backstage behind the curtain on one side. She spotted me from the other side, and as she walked across the stage, I have never seen as much anger in a human being in my life as I saw in her. She almost started crying when she saw me. She said, "Oh, I'm just so glad to see you. I got this horrible job. I hate it. I hate everything about it. I hate everybody down there." I mean, you talking about negative nails, she was it. She said, "Can you help me?" Now, understand, I've only got about 10 minutes. So I looked at her, and one thing I have learned, I don't do counseling, but I talk with a lot of people who do, in psychologists, psychiatry, and the ministry. And they tell me that everybody who comes to you with a problem are not necessarily looking for a solution. I couldn't understand that for a long time. Why do they bring you a problem if they don't want to solve it? Well, I can tell you why. They want to tell you about it, you about it, you about it, you about it, and you about it. And if you foul up the deal and solve the problem, they can't tell you again, you again. They want the attention that goes with the problem. And every company just about it has that kind of an individual. They want the attention that goes with griping and complaining. Well, I looked at the lady, and it wasn't unkindly, but firmly I said to her, "Yes, and you know, ma'am, I'm afraid your problem is about to get worse." She said, "What do you mean?" I said, "I believe they're going to fire you." She was stunned. I couldn't have stunned her more if I'd hit her in the face with a bucket of ice water. She said, "Fire me? Why on earth would they fire me?" Inflection in her voice clearly said, "They're the bad guys. I'm the good guy. Why don't they fire them and keep me?" Have you ever noticed that people who are the problem never recognize that they are? They're in complete denial. They think denial is just a river in Egypt. "Why would they fire me?" I said, "Ma'am, I don't believe there's a company in America big enough to contain this much poison in one small spot." Have you ever noticed that when somebody is about to lose something they've been complaining about, whether it's a car, a home, a mate, a job, or whatever, when all of a sudden it appears they're going to lose them, it takes on brand new value? She looked at me and said, "Well, what can I do?" I said, "Do you really want to know?" She said, "Yes, I do. That's the reason I came to see you. I came looking for help, but you sure haven't been any help so far." I said, "Well, ma'am, I've got an idea. And I will absolutely guarantee you it positively, definitely, absolutely will work if you will just do it." She said, "I'll try anything within reason." I said, "Okay, when you get home tonight, all of your household tasks are complete. It's bedtime. Get off in a room right by yourself. Get a sheet of paper out, and at the top of it, write, 'I like my job because.'" She interrupted me. She said, "That'll be easy. I don't like nothing about that job. Don't like nothing about those people down there." And I said, "Well, just as a matter of curiosity, do you work there for benevolent reasons, or do they pay you for working there?" She said, "Well, I got to confess, they pay me." And I said, "And you don't like to be paid?" "Oh," she said, "yes, I do." I said, "Okay, tell you what you do. Open your notebook right now. We'll start our list of the things you like about your job. They pay you for working there, and you do like it, don't you?" She said, "Absolutely." But she just stood there. I said, "No, open your notebook now, and we'll get busy on the list." She just stood there. I said, "Ma'am, let me tell you what my experience in life has been. I've discovered that in 100% of the cases, no exceptions, people who won't take step number one never take step number two. You see, she had come to me with an impossible dream. Her dream was that nice Mr. Ziegler was going to solve all of her problems and she would live happily ever after. Well, folks, I got news for you. I can't solve her problems. I can't solve your problems. But I will give you some steps that I'll absolutely, definitely, and positively will work for you, as it worked eventually for her. I said, well, ma'am, let me tell you something. Unless you're willing to take step number one right now, it's been nice talking with you. She angrily opened her notebook. Before we got through, there were 22 things she liked about her job. Not only did they pay her for working there, they paid her above average. She had 3 weeks vacation with pay. She had a retirement program. She was in on profit sharing. She had health insurance, life insurance, and accident insurance. She lived less than 10 minutes from home. She was in on management decisions. The company sent her to 3 seminars a year to be paid for. She had her own private office and parking place. 22 things that she liked about her job. Now I said, ma'am, when you get home tonight, everything is finished. Get off in a room right by yourself. Close the doors. Change one word from I like my job to I love my job. Get in front of that mirror. And folks, I cannot say this strongly enough, but I'm going to try. The eyes are the windows of the soul. Look yourself in the eye. And with excitement and enthusiasm, say, I love my job because they pay me for working there. I love my job because they pay me above average for working there. I love my job because I have a wonderful insurance program. I love my job before every one of the statements. You will sleep better that night. You see, there's something hidden in what I'm saying to you now. When she says, I like my job, she's really saying, I'm grateful for my job. And of all of the emotions we can have, according to Hans Selye, the number one stress specialist in America, the healthiest of all human emotions is gratitude. I said, you go down that list. I like my job. I love my job, rather. That is a way of gratitude. You'll sleep better the first night. Tomorrow morning, when you get up, get back in front of the mirror just before you go to work. Get back in front of the mirror and repeat the process again with excitement and enthusiasm. I love my job because, and take the list with you. Because the reality is, you see, you will have started to change from a fault finder to a good finder. Some people do really find fault like there's a reward for it. They really do. Take the list with you and you will be able to add to that list absolutely guaranteed. Do this every morning and every night, and you will have an astonishing recovery from this advanced case of stinking thinking. Now, I didn't say that to her, but I'm saying it to you. That's what it was. It was an advanced case of stinking thinking. Well, 6 weeks later, I was back in Birmingham, Alabama. I was doing a follow-up sales seminar. Now, the lady was not in sales. But she had been listening to my tapes. She had been listening to Automobile University. And she had discovered that everybody sells. Everybody who will ever hear this is in selling. Whether you're a school teacher, a civil service worker, a military personnel, an executive secretary, it doesn't make any difference. What you do, you sell every day of your life. There she was at the sales seminar, seated on the front row, grinning so wide she could have eaten a banana sideways. I'm telling you, you're talking about somebody that was excited. She was turned on. I said, well, how you doing? She grinned even more broadly and said, Mr. Ziegler, I'm doing wonderfully well, and thank you for asking. She said, you cannot believe how much those people down there have changed. I got to lay it on the line, folks. You're not going to change anybody else. Did you change you? Everything really does begin with you. Now, you see, the unfortunate thing, this lady had been raised in a very negative environment. First, her parents had told her that she'd never amount to anything. They said, you know, you're always late, you're always sloppy, why can't you be like your brother or your sister or whatever? When she got married, her husband had continued it, and so her self-talk had become completely negative. everything that she said about herself was negative. Like Dad said, I'll never amount to anything. Or like my husband says, I can't do anything right. But when she started changing the input, then some radical changes took place.
Ziegler. Inspiring true performance.
First slide. Now, the reason I wanted you to see that is everything I'm going to talk about communication, about listening, about leadership, is very personal to you, not to somebody else. It has everything to do with the way you come into that relationship. If it's only just a minute you're walking up to talk to somebody, or if it's somebody you've known all your life, if it's a sibling or a spouse, everything that happens in that interchange begins with you. And how you look at that and how you look at yourself. It has an impact on everything. So I wanted you to see that. If you don't know, that was Zig Ziglar. He was one of the men who started Amway. He's a billionaire. And he's been very successful all of his life. But he wasn't always that way. When he was a younger man, he struggled. He struggled mightily. And he had an opportunity, like a lot of us have, including myself, to really stand on the shoulders of some giants, some people that taught him how to change himself. And over time, he became the person you're seeing there and the very successful person that he became. So, everybody that you come into contact with every single day has the potential of changing your life in a very powerful way if you'll take the time and care about that interchange. And that's some of the things we're going to talk about. Next slide. Now, what your communication style says about you says a lot about you. Not only that, it says a lot about and communicates to you, if you know what to watch for, the people you're talking to and with. And it can greatly impact the effectiveness of the communications happening. Next slide. Not last slide, next slide. There are four styles of communication. Some of this is kind of technical stuff, but it's actually fairly simple. Expressive, systematic, sympathetic, and direct. Next slide. And some of this stuff I'll go through kind of quickly. Now, if you understand the four styles of communication, and you really understand them and you watch for them, then you can be more effective in utilizing those styles to your advantage in any kind of communication that you might have. Next slide. Expressives are high energy. They talk quickly. They focus on the big picture. They're kind of like me. I'm kind of an expressive. People like Frank, who've worked with me for years, Frank is a statistician. He's a tactician. I'm up here. And I say, well, why can't we change the shape of the world? David Allenbaugh, those of you remember, he was a tactician. So it's very good to have a tactician balanced off with an expressive. They make a good team. On their own, they're kind of limited. But together, they make a good team. So those styles can complement each other. And when you're talking to somebody and you see somebody with a complementary style to yourself, you tend to start expanding ideas and creativity, and you do some really good things. Next slide. Systematics, focus on the facts and details, just like the system, just like you'd expect. They're not comfortable with conflict. Nobody's really comfortable with conflict. How many of you like to stand and scream and yell and argue? Not you, Frank. How many people like to argue? Nobody likes to argue. You like to argue. All right, you're dismissed. No, I'm just kidding. Next slide. Directs are brief in conversation, to the point. They're going to deliver the thing they're talking about very quickly. They see the big picture, but they're more focused on the outcome of the smaller task. Next slide. And sympathetics, they're kind of based on feelings. Here's a key. Every one of you have various aspects of these four styles in you all the time. You just have one that may be a little more dominant that has evolved over time as you have grown in your skill in communicating because of your environment, mostly. Sometimes it's genetic and you get it from your parents and your grandparents, so you have certain traits. And you have one of these styles that's more dominant than the others, but you have all of these. And you can, if you start really thinking about the way you talk to people, you'll catch yourself seeing these things. Next slide. If you pay close attention to the styles, you can avoid a lot of conflict. You can also increase creativity. You can come up with better ideas. Storming is generally just crap. But if everybody is communicating and utilizing these styles effectively to talk to each other, then brainstorming starts working. And if you have a good moderator that is leading the sessions and they understand these four styles of communication and they're watching for it, they start pairing people up that are complementary and you get a lot of things done. How many of you have had really good moderators over time? Everybody's had bad moderators. Now, how many have had good moderators that paired you up with somebody that you really got along with and communicated well with? I know I have. I've also had some moderators that we want to throw out the window. One time we did. Next slide. Now, a big part of communication, the biggest part of communication, is your body language. Before I run this next one, I want everybody to raise your hand like you're going to take the oath and hold it up. Okay? Keep your hands up. Now freeze your hand where it is. Now notice my hand is firm, fingers are wide, straight up. Right? All right, that tends to mean that I am usually terrified and I'm on anything or not. If you have your hand together, that means you're going to tell the truth, but we're going to have to draw it out of you. If your hand is leaned back, and you might want to look at your neighbors, you might not be all that comfortable with people you're sitting next with, that means you're probably going to tell us a lie. And if you have your fingers apart like this, part together and part apart, like that, I worry about you. That means you're going to give us a little bit of both. We're going to have to drag it out of you, and some of it you're going to be terrified and just spill it over, so it's going to be hard to get the truth out of it. Now, that little exercise shows you a little something about body language, a very basic kind of thing. Now, when you go home tonight and you talk to your significant other, and they start telling you about their day, so what you can do is say, well, wait just a minute. Would you mind raising your hand up? Now you know. All right, run the next video.
Bill Gates and Charlie Rose are both celebrities in different respects. It is this celebrity status that allows them to overcome certain distractions while they speak. By observing their challenges, we develop opportunities for improvement.
What is your belief and your goal? What do you believe is possible for Microsoft to do in search?
Conversationalizing is moving your hands or your head in the rhythm of your speech. Notice how Charlie Rose moves his hand and head on key words. Believe. Possible. Microsoft. To do. Search. Whereas the voice can place emphasis on many words, the body cannot do the same, or it becomes a distraction. Let's play it in real time.
What do you believe is possible for Microsoft to do in search? What do you believe is possible for Microsoft to do in search?
Conversationalizing is also apparent in the movements that Bill Gates uses as he tries to emphasize key points.
Other browsing type behavior in ways that could work well for everyone.
At times, gestures may even move on every syllable. Other browsing behavior in ways could work well for everyone. Let's play it in real time.
Other browsing type behavior in ways that could work well for everyone.
Although the repetitive movements of conversationalizing can be distracting, gestures can be used effectively to explain concepts or relationships. Virtual space is used by the body to link referenced items in the voice. The challenge is to use different virtual space to identify different concepts.
Their advantage in software, their advantage in time, and how they've used their resources. Their advantage.
The hand tries to establish emphasis in space.
Their resources.
Charlie Rose is using the same virtual space for three different words. Software, time, resources. Once virtual space is used to establish a particular reference,
software,
the same space cannot be used to establish additional references.
Resources.
Even Bill Gates makes multiple references using one virtual space.
It does require incredible scale, dedication, long term, because the technology is very, very deep. Credible scale, dedication, long term, because the technology is very, very deep.
However, when a different reference occupies a different virtual space, the communication is easier. Here, Bill Gates describes different periods of time using different virtual space for each period.
Running search today, compared to what it can be, is absolutely terrible. Compared to what it was, say, 2 or 3 years ago, it's fantastic.
Notice how he identifies today, what can be,
is absolutely terrible.
And what was.
2 or 3 years ago, it's fantastic.
And although Bill Gates takes advantage of virtual space by separating items in the air, he inadvertently stumbles upon yet another challenge. It has to do with timelines.
Running search today, compared to what it can be, is absolutely terrible. Compared to what it was, say, 2 or 3 years ago.
Using a personal timeline, he establishes the present, but his right hand shows the future, his left hand the past.
2 or 3 years ago, it's fantastic.
Because the audience sees a similar timeline, past, present, future, moving left to right, they expect the right hand of the presenter to signify the past, and the left hand to signify the future. But he uses his own personal timeline in contrast to what the audience expects.
Running search today, compared to what it can be, is absolutely terrible. Compared to what it was, say, 2 or 3 years ago, it's fantastic.
And while the celebrity status of Bill Gates and Charlie Rose will have us concentrating more on what they say rather than on how they say it, we can still learn a lot from the actions they use to deliver their content.
So I wanted to show you that because not only is it okay to use your hands in communication, it's actually very effective. And using your hands conveys different messages depending upon what subject you're talking about and how you occupy different places with your hands. So they use what they call virtual space. So they deliver this so you're, as you're listening, you're watching their hands. And as you're watching their hands, you're focusing on the words they're saying because it pulls you out into that connection. So it's okay, very much okay, to use your hands, but to kind of study up, and I'm not going to teach you everything there is to know about that. I want to inspire you to go out and learn more about it by triggering the interest in you as I show you these things. Next slide. Okay. How many times have you had a conversation with somebody and you kind of feel like, well, this is not kind of going right? It doesn't feel right somehow. That's an imbalance in the conversation. So if you have an imbalance in the conversation, several things can be happening there. One, that person is distracted. They're not really focusing on what you're saying, and you're sensing that. While their eyes are on you, you're kind of sensing that their mind is not completely on what the conversation is about. It can also be that you're coming from one style, they're coming from another, and it's conflicting. You guys are not communicating effectively because you're off balance. So as the good communicator you are, you'll recognize that and start making adjustments to bring the balance back. Next slide. Okay, now let's talk about listening. Are you listening? What? Next slide. Is the audience listening? Are you listening? How many times have you had an interchange at a store, at a restaurant, in any kind of circumstance, and you tell the person very clearly what it is you want, and then you get something that doesn't resemble it at all? Look at all the hands. Now, do you think that we are an effective communicating society? Really? Why do you think that we are not? What is the one major reason why you don't remember the name of that person you introduced yourself to today? Has anybody in here been introduced to somebody today that you don't remember their name? Be honest. How many people have had that happen in the last week? The rest of you. Why does that happen? All right, there's a couple of things that are going on. One, not the major reason, you have not trained yourself to focus on that introduction. The main reason is you don't care. Now, everybody says, no, I do care. I'm not talking about caring from the standpoint of you want to take care of somebody or you want to watch out for them or your family or your friends. I'm not talking about that. You have a lot going on in your life. You are focusing on many, many, many things all the time. Everybody has all this stuff generating. Suddenly somebody comes up and says, hi, I'm blah, blah, blah. This stuff is still generating. All that stuff is flying around you all over the place. Suddenly this person's there. They're there for a couple of seconds. Then they're gone. Yeah, I'm going to remember that. One of the reasons we have business cards is because we're so terrible at remembering people's names. You might remember who they worked for. You might remember where you met them. You might remember what you were doing. You might remember what they do. You might be able to tell everything about what they were wearing. But you're not going to remember their name. So how can you get past that? What are some things you can do? Does anybody have any ideas about that? Yes. Say their name. Say their name. John, it's good to meet you. Or John, and saying their last name, it's a little awkward. But you say John, and guess what? The next day, you'll remember John, but you won't remember their last name. What are some other ways? Anybody have some tried and proven techniques for remembering somebody's name? Write their name. As soon as they leave, make a note. If they have a business card, flip it over and write something about them. Has a terrible tie. You know, when you pick up that business card and you flip it over, yeah, I remember that. Everybody has little tricks that you use, but be caring enough from the standpoint of your own sake to improve your chances, your career, your opportunity to network effectively by taking the extra step, writing down the name, saying their name, writing down something on the back of the business card, or making a note to yourself. Something about that person, when you met them, what the circumstances were, and you will remember. Then when you go back to write them an email, you don't have to say, it was great to meet you the other day. I look forward to working with you, or I look forward to hearing from you, and that's it. Because it doesn't take a genius to figure out, this person wrote to me and they have no idea who I am. But if you say, hey, it was great to meet you at, and I enjoyed our discussion about, and I look forward to hearing more about X. Now they're wanting to pay attention to you. Now they know you cared enough to remember. Next slide. Are you hard of hearing or hard of listening? Now, some of you in here might be hard of hearing. You may not know it. I wear hearing aids. Because I've had tinnitus for years, and so my hearing has been horrible for a long time. Thank God for hearing aids. Even so, I'll ask a lot of you, what? Because technology can only go so far. But hard of listening, well, that's a different kind of thing. Why would you be hard of listening? What is hard of listening? Again, all those things that are circulating around you, all those family things, those work things, those personal things, all those fears, worries, and obligations, responsibilities, and stress that you're carrying around all the time closes your ears off, just as if you stuck some plugs in your ears. Because people are talking to you, but you're not hearing it. Which side of your brain controls the right side of your body? The left. And which side of your brain controls the right side of your body? The right side is the analytical part of your brain. The left side is the creative part of your brain. It's also the part of your brain that daydreams. If you've ever driven anywhere and not remembered driving there, your left side of your brain was doing the drive. So, if you're trying to figure out an equation, and you're kind of stuck on it, if you take your right hand And this works. You take your right hand and you're using it to gesture as you speak or as you're thinking, you'll be better because you're engaging the right side of your body, which is the analytical, statistical, mathematical side of the brain. Now, if you're hard of listening, you're probably not using that side of your brain. You're probably using the other side. Have you ever had a conversation with somebody and you're kind of daydreaming while they're talking? If you say no, you're lying, because everybody has. Like the guy out there with the microphone is talking about all this stuff, and I wish he'd just get it over with. Okay, that's the left side of your brain kind of putting you on autopilot. But if you start moving, now everybody raise your right hand. Wave it around. Now you're listening to me again. Next slide. How do you play an active role in listening? What is active listening? Has anybody got a definition? Yes. That's one way. That's a good one. What's the next one? Yes, sir. I'm sorry? Acknowledge. Yes, sir. Body language. Do you ever repeat back or summarize what somebody just said? You ever try doing that? How many people repeat back? Now, I don't know about you, but it's very important for me to understand what my wife wants me to do, because my life is not nearly as pleasant if I don't do it. And she's very nice about it. But, you know, my wife likes to talk to me with her face pointed that way. And so I'm going like this, and I keep moving around, and she keeps turning around. So we're just kind of going around and around like this. So I say, okay, I think I heard you say this. And I repeat it back. Now, the first few times I do that, and I can get away with it because the old man's almost deaf, so I guess I have to do that. But if you start doing that with people and you listen to them, they will appreciate it because you're really taking the time and you care enough to make sure you understand what they just said. Here's some catchphrases that will get you out of a lot of trouble. That's interesting. Now, everybody say, that's interesting. Okay. Now, what you say after that, you've got several different ways you can go. I'm interested as to why you would say that to me. That's a good one, because now you're not on the defensive anymore. They have to tell you why they said that to you. Now, they might not be very pleasant in telling you that. And then you say, well, that's interesting. I wonder why that is. Again, they have to tell you. Well, that's interesting. Why would you do that? But you're always saying, that's interesting. That's interesting. Nice little way to get yourself out of a jam. When the supervisor comes up there, and you can see that if the eyes are dilated, are they angry? Or are they? Or when they are closed, are they angry? Which one? When their pupils are real tiny, they're not happy. So when the supervisor comes over there and the face is red and the fists are kind of doing this and the eyes are like little tiny dots, get ready to say, that's interesting. Next slide. Okay, here are some examples of how to. I saw there's so many of them. I try to scale it down. I don't like to put a lot of verbiage up there, but this is important. Face the speaker. How aggravating is it to talk to somebody and they're going over here and you have to kind of go over here to keep up with them? I remember once, I used to work for the U.S. Forest Service up in Roanoke, and we had some real characters working there. And there was one old Cajun guy that I loved him, he was great, but he was always messing with everybody. And we had a budget guy that had been there forever, and the Cajun guy, he was in procurement, I think. And they didn't get along real well, but they didn't hate each other, but he was always picking this other guy. And the budget guy, as you might expect, was one of those really down to the nitty gritty numbers. Not much of a sense of humor. And so, you know, he was kind of intimidating. I was a young guy, you know, pretty intimidating. You'll talk to this guy, especially if your expense report wasn't exactly what it should be. And I wasn't always great at that. Remember, I'm the visionary guy. So I was going to have to go and talk to him. And I was a little concerned about it. And he said, "Sanders, what's the matter with you?" I said, "Well, I'm a little concerned about talking to this guy. You know, I think he's going to chew me up." He said, "Nothing to him." I said, "Well, what do you mean?" He said, "When you go in there and you talk to him, just look at the end of his nose. Don't take your eyes off the end of his nose." After about 2 minutes, conversation would be over. I thought he was crazy. Well, I got nothing to lose, so I went and I sat down, and I started looking at the end of his nose. And after a minute or so, he was talking, and I was listening to him, but he started kind of doing this. And after about another minute, he was doing like that. And he said, "Get out. You've been talking to that crazy Cajun." Maintain eye contact. Don't look at the end of his nose. Now, there's two things to say about that. If you are looking at somebody really hard in the eye without averting your eyes, that can send a different message. That can tell people you're dishonest. Believe it or not, if you stare too deeply in somebody's eyes for too long, they lose trust. Normal eye contact, which means as you're talking to somebody, you have their eye contact, then you'll break it occasionally. Then you're again, but you're not staring at them, because then it becomes kind of a challenge, and they start losing that connection, and they start feeling uncomfortable, and that leads to distrust. Minimize external distractions. How many of you are talking to somebody and they pick up the phone and you want to take the phone and throw it out the window with them closely behind them? Or they start texting. "Hello, hello, hello, hello." I wish I'd never taught my wife how to do that. Now, respond appropriately. That's interesting. That's interesting. Works in just about every situation. And nod your eyes and raise your eyebrows. Understanding. You're following along. You care enough to listen to what they're saying, and you're following what they're saying, and you're getting information. And hopefully you will give back an intelligent response. Focus solely on what the speaker is saying. It's not so important that you get your point in. Wait. Be patient. Let them make their point. You might actually get something that will help you in responding more eloquently or with more intelligence. Next slide. Minimize internal distractions. If your own thoughts keep horning in, simply let them go. Left brain, you might even want to raise your right hand up to do this. That'll turn off the left brain, starting you to daydream. It sounds crazy, but it does work. So if you find yourself starting to daydream when somebody's talking to you, or you're listening to a presentation on effective communication, everybody do this now. And you start focusing again. It helps you break that internal distraction. Now, we don't care how you did it there. Okay, I heard that a little bit. Avoid letting the speaker know how you handle a similar situation unless they ask for your input. Zig Ziglar, when he was talking, he let that woman, he first said, "Tell me." And he was quiet and listened to what she had to say. It didn't take her long. And when she told him the problem, because he had handled similar situations many times in the past, he knew exactly what to tell her. But he also knew she would not be receptive. And so he couched his response to her incrementally, until he got to the point that says, "Man, it is in my experience 100% of the time, people who don't do the first step never make it to the second." And when she had no other choice, and he left her no other choice, "If you don't do it, I'm not going to help you." She did it. But he waited. He listened to what she had to say. He didn't tell her how he jumped in and said, "Well, I've handled it this way." He waited, and he gave her a little bit at a time. Even if the speaker is launching a complaint against you, wait until they finish. Don't become defensive.
Becoming defensive only builds the wall tighter. It only gives that individual more ammo to fight you, and it doesn't accomplish anything. Then you're both locking heads. You are not negotiating a solution to the problem if you're both screaming at each other. If two people are talking at the same time, how much can you understand from either one of them? Anytime I watch a news show and they start that and four people start talking at once, I'm done. But they do it all the time. And engage yourself. Now, engaging yourself is as simple as asking questions to help you better understand. If you assume you know everything about their problem off the bat, you won't be as accomplished as Zig Ziglar was in dealing with that woman, because, you know, he asked her a couple of questions for clarification. And based on the clarification she provided him, he was able to couch his answer in a very positive and effective way. So don't assume you know everything going on here in the first 5 seconds. There may be a whole number of things that go on. How many of you ever watched Sherlock Holmes mysteries? I love them. I watch them all the time, and I learn a lot from that. Because Sherlock Holmes, the first thing he says when he sits down, he says, "Pray, tell me everything." And he sits there very quietly. He never says a word. He listens to everything they're telling him. And then he asks a follow-up question and a follow-up question. He's not said anything. And it's not until he's way down here that he's looked at everything that he finally comes back and tells you the answer. Because he's taken in input. And Arthur Conan Doyle was one of the most brilliant minds of his age. And he wrote those stories, and he was Sherlock Holmes, and that's the way he operated. Next slide. Open questions. Rather than asking questions that only require yes or no, ask open questions. For example, instead of saying, "Has this been going on a long time?" ask, "How long has this been going on?" So if you are formulating a question in your mind, and you can answer it with a yes or no, kind of move away from that. Shift it around. You want empirical data. You want more data. The more data you get, the more immersed you're going to be in the situation, the more understanding you're going to be of the issue, and the more cognizant you're going to be of being able to deliver the solution. Summarize. Remember the active listening where you're repeating back to them? Summarize. Okay, just so that I have everything straight, that's really a good way to say that. I want to make sure that I have everything clear in my mind. If you don't mind, I'd like to summarize what we've been talking about. It only takes a minute. And then go through. And if you're off, guess what? They'll correct you real quick. And one thing that really helps with that is jot down a few notes. That does two things. That makes sure that you are keeping on track. And it also conveys to them, they care about what I'm telling them. They really care. They're writing it down. So when you finish a conversation, and let me tell you something, all conversations are important. There is no such thing as an unimportant conversation, because you never know when a kind word or the right word can change somebody's life from you. From you. I've seen it happen over and over, and you have too if you think about it. And there have been situations where you said something that impacted somebody's life. And if you don't think that's happened yet, let me tell you, it will. It will. There are no unimportant conversations. They might be brief, but there's no unimportant ones. Repeat back a word or a phrase can encourage people to go on. Some people, they kind of clam up. This is, you know, when somebody starts off a conversation with, "This is embarrassing," or "I don't feel real good about telling you this, but..." That means they really want to tell it to you. But it's going to be tough for them to get it out. So, okay, tell me. Let me know what's going on. How many of you have had a little dealings with the police? I'm not talking about being arrested. I'm talking about you just talking with the police. If you have a well-trained and seasoned police officer, they're going to be very easy to talk to. Extremely easy to talk to. And they're going to ask you questions, and they're going to be jovial about it, or they're going to be pleasant. And they're going to say, "Sir," and they're going to call you Mr. or Ms., and they're going to be very nice. So why do they do that? What's their job? All right, protect and serve, but they're also gathering evidence. Now, if they're intimidating, you're going to cross your arms, and you're not going to talk. If they just walk up and say, everything you say is going to be used against you in court of law, we'll say anything. But they'll say that, and they'll say, do you want to talk to me? Well, it seems kind of nice. Well, next thing you know, yeah, I robbed that bank. Yeah, I shot that fellow. Really? Go on. And you go on, and you go on, and you go on. Next slide. We all skirt around and gloss over the most difficult things. If we can avoid saying them, we will. There has been a number of times in my career that I have been a supervisor, sometimes of a lot of people. And supervising people is a challenge in and of itself. Those of you who have been supervisors know, and those of you who have worked for supervisors may not think it's hard, but it is. There have been certain situations where you did not want to sit down and talk to that person because there was a problem. I remember one situation. I had two women that absolutely hated each other working in the office. They didn't work directly for me, but they were in my company, and it was getting kind of bad. So we had to get something done. I didn't want to lose either one of them. They were both great employees. They did a good job. They just hated each other. Now, do you think I really wanted to pull both of them into my office and sit down and talk with them about this? No. But I also knew that if I didn't do something, it was just going to get worse and worse and worse. So I pulled them into the office and closed the door. And I said, ladies, I appreciate you coming here. I need for you to talk to me. I need for you to talk to each other. Well, they sat there with their arms crossed. What does that mean? Unless, and they're not cold. It means they're not open to discussion. So I said, if you do me a favor, uncross your arms, your legs, your toes, your knees, your fingers, and everything else you got crossed, and let's just talk. And we started off with mundane things. We didn't tackle the big one. We started off, and I asked this person, tell me what you like about your job. Tell me what you like. Like Zig Ziglar did. Well, a couple of things came out. I appreciate it. Tell me what you like about your job. A couple more came out. I went back and forth. And what great things have happened to you in the last week? On or off the job? And they just went back and forth and back and forth. Now, tell me one thing you like about this person. That was a little harder. But they were a little more conducive because they kind of relaxed. And they came in with a battle axe back behind them like this. They kind of laid the axe down. Now they can talk a little bit. And that's them. I never asked one of them what they didn't like. I knew that. But we kept at it for over 2 hours. And while they didn't become best friends, I didn't have any more battles in the office. I also gave them each a box of chocolates. It didn't hurt. All right, reacting. You don't have to be completely neutral, but you also don't have to give in. And sometimes your life can depend on it. I had a fellow working for me once. He was 6'4" and he weighed 295 pounds. And he had a real hot temper, but he was brilliant. One of the most brilliant people I've ever employed in my life. Very valuable. He got particularly angry at the people we were working with, who were in charge of the contract that I was managing. One day, I was in my office, and I didn't get a knock on the door. My office door exploded and landed on the floor. This wasn't a small door. And my guy was standing in the doorway, filling it, and he was breathing heavily, and he was wild-eyed, and I said, I was sitting at my desk. I didn't get up. I sat still. I said, having a bad day? I said, would you mind sit down and tell me about it? There was a long, troubling silence, punctuated by the sound of a bull, and then he took a couple of steps to the chair and he sat down hard. I thought the chair was going to collapse. I didn't say anything. We just sat there, and I waited. It's about 5 minutes. I didn't know whether he was going to kill me, he was mad at me, or what he was angry about. But after about 5 minutes, he started telling me his frustration with the people that were employing us. And again, for about 15 minutes, I didn't say a word. I let him tell me everything that he had on his mind. I didn't raise my hands. I didn't open my mouth. But I listened. And after I saw there was a little drop in the animosity, I asked him a couple of clarifying questions. And after we got calmed down a little more, I let him tell me some more things outside the job. I found out he had some things going on that were really upsetting him off the job. And what happened, stuff on the job wasn't that bad, but it exacerbated the condition that he came into work with. So we kind of traced it back very gently, because I didn't want to lose my life that day, to its source. And before he left, he was in tears over a number of things. So he got his frustration out. And then we started talking about how we can avoid this situation and how we can effectively communicate. And we talked about what's good about the job and what do our employers do well. Not what they did bad, what do they do well? What kind of things do they provide for us that makes it a good place to work? And why is it important for us to be as good as we can be working for the people who pay us? He shook my hand and he said, he gave me the greatest compliment I ever got, given who it was coming from. He said, I've never felt comfortable calling anybody boss in my work life. And he said, it's a pleasure to work for you, boss. All I did was let him talk. It's not that hard. All right, let's take a break. In 10 minutes, finish eating that good food, and we'll start back up. All right. All of this sounds simple, and it is, and all you're doing is listening, and from time to time giving responses, which encourage the other person to keep on talking. And sometimes that's the most important thing. The more they talk, the more information they share, the more you learn, the more effective you can be in resolving whatever issue may be going on, or the more effective you can be in cementing that relationship. Next slide. All right, run the next video.
So if you've ruled out any medical problem and your child is still wetting the bed, he may be trying to tell you something.
He's telling you, I have to pee.
So I think we're going to wrap it up for tonight. But before we do, are there any other questions? Yes, Deborah.
Yeah. We have a 6-year-old daughter, and she's a great kid, but she's been having trouble listening, and she's been very stubborn lately.
But that's every kid.
It's not.
It's just a phase, right?
Well, this is a perfect opportunity for you to try some active listening.
Thank you. We'll try that.
Wait a second. Wait. So active listening, I'm not familiar with that.
Well, it's encouraging your child to express herself verbally without influencing her with your own preconceived notions or opinions.
Got it. Here we go.
Well, why don't we try to illustrate this with a little role playing? Let's have you. Ray, is it?
No.
Come to the front of the class.
Why don't you go? Why don't you go, Deb?
Fine. Don't be shy. Now, Ray, let's just say that I'm your daughter, and I refuse to go to visit Grandma on her birthday.
Well, in this case, I happen to know Grandma, and I can't say I blame you.
Just hypothetically, Ray, all right? Now, let's just say, Ray, that you want to get from your daughter what she's really feeling. Go ahead.
Okay. Daughter, you have to go to Grandma's house.
I'm not going.
Well, you have to go. It's her birthday.
I hate when you make me do things.
Look, I'm not making you go, okay? It's Grandma's birthday. There aren't going to be many more of them.
Oh. See, I'm going to stop you just for a second, Ray. You see, I don't think at this point we need to discuss Grandma's mortality.
Oh. Doing, Ray? Don't...
I'm playing the game.
It's not a game.
It's okay. It's okay. Ray, if I say to you, I hate when you make me do things, perhaps you could acknowledge my feelings by saying something like, you feel you don't have any control over our plans. You understand?
That doesn't sound like something I would say.
Just takes a little practice. Come on, let's keep going.
Yeah, let's...
All my friends are going to the park, but I have to go to some boring party?
You think that the party's going to be boring?
That's it, Ray. See, you're reflecting her feelings back. Yes! It's just a bunch of grown-ups sitting around an old house. I want to be with my friends.
But Grandma has that big bowl of coffee nips.
I don't care. And you can't make me.
What are you doing?
I'm not going.
Please, get up. Get up.
Why do I have to go?
Well, I don't know.
But why?
Why? Because I said so. Huh? That was big when I was a kid. Mommy said you gotta go.
Leave Mommy out of it, Ray.
Thank you.
Look, you better get up or...
Or what?
Or no more TV.
No, Ray.
Okay, or you're going to boarding school.
Do you always threaten?
No. No, sometimes she yells.
Oh, Ray. I'm sorry, we've run out of time. Thank you all for coming. I'll see you next week. Ray and Deborah, I'd like you to stay after class, please. I think we need to talk.
Yes, come on.
Oh.
You raise your hand.
Okay, it's easy to talk about active listening and easy to talk about all these wonderful things when I'm up on the stage and I've got these things up here and you're listening, hopefully, and learning, hopefully. But when you get in the actual world and you start applying these things, how do you make it work? Practice. 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 How many of you are musicians? You play a musical instrument. Did you just pick it up one day and start playing? You did, but it sounded terrible, didn't it? It took a lot of practice, didn't it? And over time, you got better. This is no different. You've been communicating all of your life. Many of you, very, very well. Some of you, maybe not so well. But everybody can benefit from practicing effective communication, active listening, in every circumstance. And there's always lots of opportunity to practice. You've got a room full of people here. One reason I encourage you so much to come is because you can practice these techniques. You can network. You can get to know each other. You can improve your communication, your listening abilities by coming here. Because you have peers here that have lots of things in common with you that you all want to learn, you all want to share. It's a great opportunity for you to communicate in a non-threatening environment. So I encourage you to keep coming and keep talking to each other, make friends, remember names, write them down, say their name. I don't have you wear name badges for a reason. I want you to work on remembering names and caring about the people you're having the exchange with. There's lots of ways to get off track. If somebody doesn't like the job, they haven't filled out the 22 things on the list, they're watching the clock. Politics, especially this time of year, which I encourage everybody to vote, that is a right that you have been given by the death and sacrifice of many, many of your fellow Americans. Don't disregard it. Whether it's primaries or main elections, vote, please. The good old cell phone, which BlackBerry is kind of going downhill these days, so it's an old slide. But minimize the distractions. When you're going to have a conversation with somebody and somebody calls you, how hard is it to say, let me call you right back? Because if you take that call, I'll have to take this call. You're telling that person, you're not as important as the person who just called me. I was having the conversation with you, and I've just disregarded you, and I'm going to talk to this person. Do you do that when you're standing talking to somebody and somebody walks up? Do you immediately say, all right, shut up, let me hear what you've got to say? No, you don't. That's rude, and you know it is. You're going to listen to that person, and at the appropriate moment, say, can you excuse me a minute, hear what they have to say, and then come back to the conversation. That's an appropriate way to do it. Same thing with this. How many times you've been in a store and you're having this exchange with the person that's helping you, and suddenly they get this phone call, and all at once you're not being waited on anymore, and now you're standing there waiting for them to finish the conversation, which all they had to do was say, I'm with someone, let me call you right back. Nobody gets offended when I won't go call you right back. Well, if they say, well, you know, the house is on fire, well, you're kind of going to break off the conversation and go fix the house. But that's not going to happen very much. Just, excuse me, I'm talking to someone. Or you say to the person, excuse me, let me answer this, but I'm going to come right back to you. And you answer it, it's my wife. Okay, honey, I'm going to call you right back. My wife always says, okay, she understands, because we do that a lot. All right, next slide. What are some more complications you have to listening? This guy's asleep. Well, who's at fault? Is the person listening or is the person communicating? What's the person communicating? He's talking a lot of dollar signs there, so it's probably numbers and so forth. He's thinking with which side of his brain? Communicating with which side? The right side. Well, the person on the left side is doing what? Now, the left side is now taken over and he's asleep. So, even if somebody's talking to you about something that's not awfully interesting, the chances are you're going to find something out in that interchange of information that's going to be useful to you. So focus on finding out something that's going to be useful to you, to understand the person, to understand the situation, or to make yourself better. Chances are you're going to find something, even in the most boring of conversations, you're going to find something of value. Next slide. And we're talking here about mind and body working in unison. That's why I told you about the right side and the left side. That's why I told you about focusing, eye contact, looking in their eyes, focusing on the words, using your hearing. When you shake hands with somebody, how do you shake hands? Do you shake hands straight on? Do you turn your hand this way? Do you put your hand on theirs? Do you put your hand on the shoulder? Do you pull them towards you? Do you do this? Okay. What does a weak handshake say to you? What's your impression? What? Lack of confidence? Somebody said distrust? What happens when somebody shakes your hands and turns it this way? You ever had somebody shake your hand and turn it that way? That's exactly right. It is an unconscious move toward dominating the relationship or dominating the exchange. You turn the hand. What happens when somebody shakes hands and puts their hand on your shoulder? What do you feel? When they put their hand on your shoulder, shake hands and put their hand on your shoulder. Yes, and what else? What do you see? When somebody comes up and shakes hand, puts their hand on her shoulder and it looks in your eye and says, I'm really glad to see you. How does that make you feel? Confident? Oh, no, I'm not talking about sexuality. You feel neutral about it. Okay? Is that what you're saying? I'm trying to make sure I understand what you're saying. So, one of the key moves of leadership that they teach you in some of the executive schools is to instill confidence in you as a leader if you're in that role. Now, if you're not in that role, that's when what you were talking about comes into play. But if somebody's a recognized leader, they're the CEO, they're the CIO, they're the leader of a user group, they come up and do that. That is a move, a leadership move, showing I care about you. You're important to me. You see a lot of politicians do that. They teach that. That's one of the things that you're taught if you go to the University of X Executive School of Management. They teach you those kind of things. And it does work. It has a positive impact, but only, like you heard, you saw the video with Bill Gates, they can get away with things because of their celebrity status. If you occupy a certain role in the eyes of the people that you are working with, there's certain behaviors they expect from you. There's certain ways of interchange and exchange of communication they expect from you. And that's why it's important that you learn these things from leaders, from people who know leadership. And that's one of the, you know, every one of you here has the potential to be a leader. Every single one of you. I'm not going to live forever. Somebody's got to run this thing. So every one of you has that potential. So what I'm trying to impart to you is some of the basic tenets of leadership in my next section. Next slide. Ask questions, listen, give time, restate, and summarize. Anybody have any questions about that? That's pretty clear, simple stuff. None of this stuff is rocket science. I mean, you know, it's not hard. Next slide. Any man who can drive safely while kissing a pretty girl is simply not giving the kiss the attention it deserves. Albert Einstein, a known ladies' man. Next slide. Play the video. This is an example of not hearing or listening very well. One of my favorite from Hank Hill. I'm sorry for the poor quality of the video, but it gives you it tells you what happens if you're not really listening, active listening well. All right, now we're going to get into leadership. Next slide. All right, the characteristics of a successful leader. Pretty standard stuff: motivating, encouraging, smart. Well, that's not always applied. Professional, visionary, flexible, objective, and fair. Every single one of us have all those traits. Every single one of you have all those traits. How many of you lead organizations, companies, associations, are either now or have in the past? Several of you. Several of you. What's the difference? What's the difference in those that are leading and those that don't? One word. Choice. Choice. That's it. Choice. You haven't chose to do so. Because every single one of you out there have the same skills of communication that I do inside of you. You may not have honed them as much. You may not have practiced them as much. Every one of you out there has the potential to be a musician if you dedicate yourself and you make that choice. It's a choice. You know, I chose to do it because somebody asked me to. And I thought it might be cool to try. And the first few years here, I was horrible. I was terrible. I made so many mistakes. People run away from here like there was a riot going on. But over time, I practiced. I kept practicing. Kept practicing. Kept practicing every day. When I made a mistake. It's one of my forehead is not completely flat. I made so many mistakes. But I kept at it because, you know, one day I said, I want to get good at this. Or better. And I just kept at it. And then people started coming. And they kept coming. And they kept coming. And then it became a habit. Next slide. Problem solving, communicating, planning ahead, and delegating tasks. I got pretty good at that. Frank will swear to that on a stack of Bibles. But you have to learn to delegate the authority along with the responsibility, because that means you got to turn loose of it. You can't hold on to the authority if you're going to ask somebody to get the job done. I'm going to have a speaker at the end that will talk about that. One of the great leaders of our time. You know, when I used to be at Comenius, and leaders of other user groups would ask me, what makes a good leader? I always said one thing that was more important than anything else. It's not about you. It's not about you. It's about what you can do to make everybody else better. That's a big job. That's a big job, but you do it. When you eat a pie, like Zig said, she was eat a banana sideways. Now, that's quite an image. But when you eat a pie, you don't shove the whole thing in your mouth, do you? Well, at least most of us don't anyway. But you eat a piece at a time, pretty soon it's all gone. And then you got to go to the gym. But you eat a little bit at a time. So in leadership, you learn these things a little bit at a time. You learn how to mentor people. You learn how to speak to people. You know how to, you get over your fear of standing up and talking to people. And it's not that hard. Once you do it a few times, it gets a lot easier. How many of you are public speakers? You've done speakers? Yeah, we got a bunch in here. We got a bunch in here. And what's the difference between them and everybody else that says, I'm not going to do that? Choice. Choice. If you choose to do it. Now, I'm not talking about, oh, I think I will. No. If you choose to do it, say, I'm going to do that. I'm going to do that. I am going to do that. You will. And you know what? You'll get good at it. And it'll become second nature to you, and it'll make you better. It'll make you better. Next slide. Are you a leader? How many of you look at yourself as a leader? Now, you might not be leading an organization. You might be leading the people in your family. You might be leading one person. How many leaders have we got? Now, the rest of you, put your hands up. Everybody. Because every single one of you is a leader, whether you realize it or not. Whether you realize it or not, somebody looks to you for inspiration. Somebody looks for you for example. Somebody looks to you to be what they want to be. Whether they're 5 years old or 50, somebody's looking to you. I guarantee it. And you can be everything you want to be if you make the choice. And you can get everything. This is something else I learned from Zig. You can get everything you want out of life if you can help enough other people get what they want. And I add this myself. Don't care about who gets the credit. Because it'll come. It'll come. Next slide.
My name is Amy Wilkinson. I'm a White House fellow. My question is how you would define the key characteristics of effective leadership that allow you to go and be an advocate for good.
Trust. The longer I have been in public service and the more people have asked me about leadership over the years, leadership ultimately comes down to creating conditions of trust within an organization. Good leaders are people who are trusted by followers. Leaders take organizations past the level that the science of management says is possible. One of my sergeants back in the infantry school at Fort Benning almost 50 years ago, which is where I learned everything I ever got to learn about leadership, was at the infantry school. And he said to me one day, he said, Lieutenant, you'll know you're a good leader when people follow you, if only out of curiosity. I've never had a better definition, because what he was saying, and I've seen it, experienced in my life so many times. What he was saying is, they trust you, and you have built up that trust. How did you do it? Clear mission and statement, selfless service. People look to you and they trust you because you're serving selflessly as the leader, not self-serving, selflessly, and that you prepare the followers, you train them. You give them what they need to get the job done. Don't give them a job if you're not going to give them the resources, and that you're prepared to take the risks with them. And so they would teach us at the infantry school, no matter how cold it is, Lieutenant, you must never look cold. No matter how hungry you all are, Lieutenant, you must never appear hungry. No matter how terrified you are, Lieutenant, you must never look terrified. Because if you are scared, terrified, hungry and cold. They will be scared, terrified, hungry and cold. I've gotten away with that many, many times in the course of my career by being scared to death, cold, and wanting to go to sleep. But no, let's go. Let's keep going. Let's go around this corner, if only out of curiosity. And they'll follow you into the darkest night, down the deepest valley, up the highest hill, if they trust you. So the essence of leadership is about doing all that the science of management says you can with resources, but then taking that extra step and giving it that spark. And that spark comes from getting people to trust you so that they will follow you, if only out of curiosity. Thank you.
That's some pretty powerful words coming from a very powerful leader that has been very successful. And, you know, you've got to be trustworthy. And it goes back to what we've been talking about, communication, about being sincere, about caring, about granting that trust, granting that confidence, being believable, listening. Everything we've talked about is one whole. At the break, somebody said, well, you know, I heard the same kind of things you're talking about in marriage counseling. This is not reinventing the wheel. This is common sense. That's why I call it common sense leadership, because it's all about using those basic tools that every one of us has, practicing, using them effectively over time with the people you care about, and through that process, making yourself better. So that's my presentation. I hope that you learned from it. I hope you enjoyed it. And if you have any questions, you know, feel free. Thank you. Thank you very much.